All right, everybody. What's up? What's up? We here. Somebody got the... Who's turned up? Okay.
That was me.
That was you.
Trying to make some trouble already.
The troublemaker is here.
Yes,
sir. The troublemaker is here. The troublemaker is here.
This is going to be fun.
This is going to be fun. This is definitely going to be some fun. Everybody, thanks for watching. This is political talk tonight. We got a couple of friends of mine in the building. This guy right here, you already know this guy. He's been here. This is your third time?
Yeah, I believe so.
Pull your mic a little bit closer and kind of get it lined up with you. So
there we go.
There you go. Now you can hear it in your. All right. This is Pete Lumaj, everybody. I got my sound effects because my computer's updating. Pete Lumaj is in the building, and next to him, a new guy. But we talked before the show came on, and he's ready. Pete has, let me just make sure I say it right, Cianelli.
You got it.
Pete Cianelli's in the building. Pete Lumaj is in the building. Fellas, what's going on?
Well, thank you for having us, man. And I heard that your daughter actually got her permit to drive a car, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, she got her permit to
drive a car.
I'm in for, she's driving already.
It's a blessing.
Yeah, it's definitely a blessing. I'm happy for her. She's making all these damn plans, and I don't know where she's going to get the money from for all these plans, but.
Well, she can get a job eventually. I mean,
she can
know.
Get, she's 16, so
I mean,
she can get a
job. She's being raised by a Republican, isn't she?
We got to see. So, I was talking to the other Pete before we got here. We have a new president, Joe Biden.
Who's that?
Joe Biden.
He's I've never heard of him.
Got me off to a running start.
Rob, before we start, I want to thank you for having me this evening, and thank you so much for covering our Trump rally and the Freedom Rally in East Haven in September.
Absolutely.
And Pete, as always, thank you for participating in that rally. We had a great time and a great turnout.
It was a pleasure, actually.
So I was asking Pete before we... Can everybody hear in your headphones and everything?
Yeah, we can. Good.
Yeah.
But I was asking Pete, the other Pete, before we started, the insurrection. Did an insurrection happen and did Trump start it?
Is this me?
We can start with
you. Okay, start with me. First of all, there was no such thing as an insurrection.
Okay.
There's no such thing right now, because if there was going to be an insurrection, we would have known about it.
Right.
And it wouldn't have been with 50 people going inside the building.
Right.
It would have been more like 5,000. Now, you know what? Everybody's pulling this. You know, we have fencing and walls around the White House and around Congress, but we don't have the walls around the border where thousands of people are walking in now. So, you know what, this is something that's uncontrollable, and it's got out of hand, and Joe Biden is not my president.
Joe Biden is not your president.
Look, when you look at what they call the armed insurrection, when the FBI agents were questioned by the United States House of Reps, actually the intelligence division, if you will, and when they asked them, once you arrested these people or prior to, were they armed? Did they have guns? The answer was no. How can you call that an armed insurrection when nobody had a gun? And the only ones who had guns actually there were the guards that were protecting the Capitol. And the interesting thing is this, that you have a sergeant at arms that protects the House of Representatives, and you have another one that is in charge to protect the U.S. Senate. Both of them were under the control of Democrats. And both of them failed us. No one should attack the Capitol of the United States. Absolutely no one. You should never attack any federal building, any private property, anyone's property. And I completely disagree with the way it was handled by the Democrats. Nancy Pelosi is responsible and Chuck Schumer is responsible for failing to protect the people that we elected to represent us in D.C. So why should Trump be blamed for that? No matter what happens, Trump was blamed for 4 years and is going to be blamed for the next 4 years. And, you know, he's unfortunate, but just by blaming the prior administration for the current failures or the failures of the current administration, we're not going to move forward this way. We're just going to have to, you know, face reality. Democrats are failing us right now. They are in charge of the House of Representatives. They are in charge of the Senate. They are in charge of the presidency. They pretty much, it's a one-party system. Look at the prices, the gas prices right now. Look at the inflation. Look at the currency depreciation. Look at the purchasing power.
I was looking at gas prices this morning.
This is ridiculous, but you have to understand one thing, that when you have some inflation, the government benefits, because once the prices go higher, we pay more taxes. That means the government is collecting more taxes from us. And we should understand one thing, that the Federal Reserve, if they keep on printing money and the currency depreciates, you and I are not able to purchase with the same amount of money that what we purchased last year. We're going to purchase less for a higher price, and the government is collecting taxes from us. So this is where I disagree with the current administration when it comes to the economy.
Oh, Pete, you wanna?
Well, you know what, Pete's nailed it right on the head, and it is out of control. And the debt right now is, I think, it's at $30 trillion, and you know that's unsustainable. And once we get 20% of GDP in the debt, it's not going to be able to come back.
Look, we just passed $1.9 trillion, the so-called virus, you know, bill, whatever they want to call it. But the interesting thing is this, that American citizens are going to get $1,400 from the federal government. But if you divide the amount of money, the $1.9 trillion that we just passed as a package, you divide it by the number of people that live in the United States. That means we're going to wind up paying back almost $6,000 for $1,400 that we're getting. So that is not a deal for us. You have so many pet projects that are getting billions and billions of dollars. They are creating voting blocks with the taxpayers' money to make sure that they get reelected. This is not about helping the American people. What the American people need is that you open the states, you open the cities, you open the economy, you create jobs, you lower inflation, you strengthen the currency, and you allow the American people to live their God-given rights of creating wealth and equity. And we're not allowing them to do that.
So you think the $1,400 is a bad idea?
It's a joke.
Oh, yeah.
It's
yeah.
a joke. First of all, it is our money. Why should the government say that I'm sending you a check from the government? We paid into that. That's our money. That's the taxpayers' money. But we don't need the $1,400. We need jobs. We need the economy to get up and running again. The strongest economy in the world is being destroyed, and this is not good.
Yeah, well, you know, I look at it this way. Why am I receiving, and my wife receiving, $1,400? I received my Social Security. I have a pension. I didn't lose any money. Give it to the poor businesses that weren't allowed to open, the restaurants and the bars and the everybody that weren't allowed to work. You know, they said everybody was the most important people were going to work. Everybody's important.
Right.
The guy that picks up your garbage is important. You know, I don't know where their mindset is coming from, but this was all planned, I believe. This was a big plan. They wanted to get Trump out, and the only way they could do it is with this pandemic. China was responsible. It happened in China, and it was a bioweapon, and there's no one else that's going to convince me otherwise.
So you believe this was all planned?
Oh, of course I do. Do
you believe the election was fake?
I don't know. You know what? It's
as part of the plan. I mean,
I don't know. You know, I really don't know. I really didn't get into that because I wanted to see the proof myself. But if the Supreme Court rejected to hear the cases, I just didn't understand when I woke up and when I went to bed at 11 o'clock. Trump was leading in Pennsylvania by 300,000 votes, and then by 8 o'clock the next morning he was down by 20,000. I don't know how that happened.
Okay.
I think the Supreme Court decided not to hear the case.
They were afraid.
In 2020, when Joe Biden was running for president, he threatened the Supreme Court that he said, if I win and I'm going to get the House and the Senate, I'm going to pack the Supreme Court. And once you pack the Supreme Court, if you were to do that, the president, all he needs is 50 plus one of the House and 50 plus one of the Senate. And he can nominate and appoint as many Supreme Court justices as he wants. Now, Supreme Court, the Chief Justice Roberts, he's very protective of the Supreme Court. He realized that the court is being threatened. And once you threaten that court, if it were to be packed, it loses one of the most essential part of being independent. because that you would change the independence of the court by having more justices there. So what he did, he said, I'm pretty much, we're not going to hear the case. We're not going to get into a fight with the president. He will become the president. I'm not hearing these allegations. Was the election stolen? Look, if you ask the Republicans, they will tell you, yeah, it was stolen. If you ask the Democrats, they will tell you it was not. But when it comes to voter fraud in our state, in the state of Connecticut, from 1992 to present, there were 29 elected or appointed officials in our state that were either investigated, arrested, or convicted for voter fraud in our state. So if it happened in our state 29 times, who is to convince me that didn't happen this year nationwide?
It happened 29 times.
29 times. I mean, in 2 years ago, you had elected officials in Bridgeport, the Ayala family, that they got arrested. Then they were charged with voter fraud. One of them went to prison because of that, or negotiated a plea. But voter fraud is there. Is it so significant that changed the outcome of the presidential election? I don't know. I don't have the answer. But is voter fraud,
It's a possibility.
Absolutely.
Okay. Okay.
Absolutely. I mean, you remember when Tom Foley was running for governor, that was, I think, 2012, when they found almost 6,000 ballots in some office in Bridgeport, and the following day they were counted, actually. There were over 300 people who voted from absentee ballots, and they used the exact same voting address, which turned out to be a parking lot. It was not even a house. So these things did happen, and when I was running for Secretary of the State, I investigated these allegations to make the argument to the voters that, look, we need voter ID. We have to stamp this thing out because voter fraud does exist.
Wow. So can Trump run again in 2024?
Of course he could.
They're trying to recruit him as we speak. I think that whether it's going to be Trump or Trumpism without Trump, this mega movement that he created, it's going to remain with us for years to come. This movement didn't start with Trump. It started with Ross Perot, 1992, when people got just tired of both the Republicans and the Democrats. Right. Trump was able to shave this movement.
Okay.
And I think Trumpism is going to remain with us for years to come.
I agree with you 100%.
Now,
the Republican Party is Trump's party right now.
It's his party.
And I don't think anybody could change it right now. You know, you got the Mitt Romneys and the Liz Cheneys, you know, that are trying to, they're not going to go anyplace.
And they're Republican. I know Mitt Romney, Liz Cheney's, that's Dick Cheney's daughter.
Exactly.
She's a Republican.
She's a Republican. Well, both parties are struggling right now. There's a civil war in the, for lack of a better word, in the Republican Party. You have the Trumpists, if you want to call them, who appear to be the majority at this point. And then you have the elites within the Republican Party, that they are trying to drag us back into being what we used to be as Republicans. When you hear Mitch McConnell say that, look, I did everything I could to help Trump. What he's saying pretty much to the media is that, look, I tried to rein this guy in. I tried to turn him into a Washingtonian, one of the boys here, but he refused to do so. So that means I didn't do a damn thing. I just tried to convince him to become one of us.
Don't forget, Pete, Trump ran on the position that he was going to change Washington. Yep. And, you know, you have to admit, Mitch McConnell's part of the swamp.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. But then the same thing applies to the Democrat Party. Now you have the left wing of the party, the socialist wing of the party, that is pretty much predominating the ideology of the party right now. You have the Ocasio-Cortez's they openly tell us that they are socialists. So both parties are struggling with the, you know, are they going to be center-right or center-left, or they are going to balance, you know, the power within the party. So we're going to see some struggle within both parties for the next 2 years or so.
Definitely. It's going to be a really changed country.
You think so?
No matter what happens, everything's going to change. I don't think for the better. You know, I'm in my 70s, and I really fear for what's going to happen to my grandchildren.
Okay.
Because they're not going to have the life that I had.
Okay.
I really feel that right now. And, you know, this just didn't start the last couple of years. This was going on right after the Vietnam War, when all these kids went to college, and the indoctrination of the kids went generation to generation. And I saw it happen in my own family in East Avon Academy.
Okay.
Where my granddaughter, we went there, she was a student of the month. This was in 2012. And they did a play on bringing up Christopher Columbus on crimes against humanity. The play was beautifully done. They were in their all British suits and everything in the courts. But at the end, they hung him for his crimes. And everybody in the crowd stood up and clapped. And I said to my wife, I said, you believe what's happening here? This is what they're teaching our kids? Christopher Columbus was bad?
Right.
It's, you know, slavery went, if we change the subject, from the beginning of time. Who do you think built the pyramids? You don't think the Egyptians elite built it. They had the slaves built it.
Right.
And now, it's continuing today. Slavery is very dominant in all the Muslim countries.
Right.
You know?
I mean, these are sensitive issues and subjects that we as Americans are going to have to come to terms to deal with and talk about it and talk freely about it. The biggest problem that I see is that we're changing our nation ideologically. What we're trying to do, what the Democrats are trying to do, they are trying to replace the Republican form of government that we have with judicial decisions and have major policy outcomes determined by unelected officials and imposed upon the entire nation. When you look at major policy issues for the past years, some years, you look at whether you're talking about abortion, it was never voted by the American people. It was the Supreme Court that decided that. Those are unelected officials. Then you look at gay marriage, the same thing. You look at Obamacare, the same thing. You look now at what they are trying to impose upon our schools, that they are telling us that transgender men, pretty much guys dressed like girls, they should be able to play good in sports. The women's teams.
Oh,
and imagine my son being 6'9", 250 pounds. He plays basketball. He's in Washington, D.C. And if he were to play against your daughters, just this is insanity. And that's what they are changing forever. That's why we should, as Americans, regardless of our political affiliations, just think about this. Before we allow some nine guys or girls in black robes in Washington, D.C. to dictate our lives in Connecticut. I mean, we're going to have to rethink this. I mean, do we really agree with this? Can we have a debate first? Can we analyze what's going to happen years from now if we pass this kind of imposition up on the people? So these are things that we're going to have to think about.
Pete, I have a granddaughter in Lyman Hall and another one going to Lyman Hall next year, and they're both basketball players. And I'm trying to talk to my daughters and say, guys, you got to get involved in this. There's a lawsuit in Connecticut right now that's happening. We have to win this lawsuit. Or you know what? You might as well just take your kids, your girls out of sports because they're never going to be able to compete against a biological man.
You just can't. I mean, it's just natural. It's just
so natural. Who's doing was that? Is that a political doing or is just...
Of course, everything that's done is political.
Okay.
Look, it is, you know, once you erase identities, if you will, and God-given identities, whether we like it or not, I mean, you know, you're either a man or a woman or boy or girl. I don't care what you wear. I don't care how you shave. I don't care what you do. You still have testosterone because you were created by God to have testosterone. And a woman doesn't have that. And you either have genitalia. We don't. You don't.
Right.
So I don't care what you do. But 2 weeks later, if you... don't take the hormones and all that thing that, you know, people would have to take. I mean, you're still a guy. So I think this is a violation of the created order of things. And we are confronting the created order, which is God himself that we are confronting. And this is insanity, what we're doing with our society, from my point of view. Look, I grew up in a communist country.
Right.
I've seen what the government can do to its people once they control the people. And we are at the verge of being completely under the command and control of the government. I was in Washington, D.C. a few days ago, and I'm going again tomorrow. There are 22,000 American troops right now in Washington, D.C. Protecting who? Why do I have to walk in my nation's capital being searched by soldiers? We have more troops in Washington, D.C. than we have in Afghanistan and Iraq combined. For what?
Now, what they say is that because of the insurrection?
Oh, but that was January 6th. Not 15 people who are crazy. Arrest those and put them behind bars, but let us live free. That is the house of the people.
Okay.
It's an embarrassment before the world to see United States Capitol being... It's barbed wire and tanks and military and guns and... What is this? It should never happen.
This was all a plan. This virus... It was so easy to control the population by fear. We lost our freedoms and liberties by a virus.
Yep, I know.
And the people didn't fight back. They wore their masks. They were afraid to go out. You know, I was never afraid to have my grandkids. My grandkids were over every single day for the last year. I wasn't going to. I know friends of mine that haven't seen their grandkids in a year.
This is...
You know, that's crazy.
It is. It is. Absolutely, it is. But,
you know, if I fear dying of this virus, then I'm already dead.
Look, it's the interesting thing. When a couple of weeks after the election, I was driving and I was listening to WR on the radio. And when I heard one of the commentators announcing that the infection rate in hospitalization is dropping precipitously, and I'm like, 2 weeks after the election, all of a sudden infection is dropping and hospitalizations are dropping, and now Cuomo's in under investigation for pretty much falsifying the whole thing and not handling it properly. But was this a political, you know, thing? And you know,
you said that election. To me. You said when the election is over, the virus is over.
Yeah, I said that too.
That's it.
Yeah, yeah, you're right.
I wonder if Cuomo's going to give back his Emmy.
Yeah. Remains to be seen. Sure.
Well, you know what, Rob? We have become a nation of idiots.
Right.
You know, blaming cartoons and statues on all our problems.
Right. So Biden, he's been around for a long time, right?
Yeah, 47 years in public office.
He doesn't know anything else. He's never held a job.
He doesn't even know his name right now.
He graduated from law school, became an attorney, got elected, and he's been, you know, pretty much living on the taxpayers, though, since then, 47 years.
He's a wealthy man.
And that's why you should have term limits.
Okay.
I firmly believe that. I mean, it's not the problem with our political system is not the president or the presidency, because no matter how crazy Trump is or was or how crazy Biden is, you cannot destroy United States for 4 years or 8 years. But you have these guys and girls who have been in United States Senate and Congress for 47 years and 50 years. They are the problem. You cannot tell me that Trump came to be the president 4 years ago, and in 4 years he caused all these problems, but Chuck Schumer and Nancy Pelosi and others who have been there for 50 years never resolved the problems that they are telling us that they are going to resolve them now. Why should he trust them now? I think there should be a term limit. You serve for two terms, three terms. The founding fathers wanted us to have a government where ordinary citizens like you and I will go to Washington, serve the public a term or two, and you go back to the private practice. And now it became a profession to be a politician. And that's what's destroying us, is that professional political, you know, elite that we have created.
Okay. Another name for you, Kamala Harris.
I'm just joking.
Kamala Harris, the vice.
I like her for one reason. She was very truthful when she called Biden a racist. She was right. Biden is a racist. That's the whole party is racist. But then the whole party. Look, when you want to do away with things that are somehow offensive and racist related in our nation, you start with the Democrat Party, because the Democrat Party was built on racism and is a racist party. You go back to the 1800s. They created KKK, which was the military wing of the Democrat Party. They segregated us. They enforced segregation until 1960s. All Democrats didn't allow people to go to schools that they wanted, to travel on the same buses. They were the ones who, you know, enforced this. And what they are doing now, they are trying to create a permanent underclass in the United States that is dependent on the government.
Can we grab this call?
Of course.
Go ahead, call us. The Raw Report. Talk to us.
Hello. I'd like to ask one of your guests a question. This guy, Peter Lumaj. Look, I was a member of the Republican Party my whole life, but Trump just really, I feel like he ruined the party. Whether here in Connecticut or all over the country, the guy was just a complete shame and joke. What do you believe the Republican Party should do to unify, whether at the state level here in Connecticut or nationally? And what do you make about this whole void in the Connecticut Republican Party? Nobody's stepping up to run for chair. Any ideas on that?
Look, if I supported the president, it doesn't mean that I supported the persona. I supported what he stood for, and I think the Republicans supported his ideas. When he was talking, putting America first, I'm part of that America. I live here, and I liked it. I think it energized the base, and everything that he promised during the campaign, he kept those promises. And that's why many people in Washington were shocked that we have a leader, not a politician, that is making promises and keeping those promises. And, you know, was he, you know, ashamed to the party or bringing shame to the party? I didn't see that in that way. Again, I mean, I don't think that one individual can destroy a political party. But in this case, I think we had 75 million people who voted to reelect him. And that was the largest number of votes a Republican has ever received in United States history. So if they disliked him so much, and if he was so bad, how come he got more? He got 38,000 votes more in our state of Connecticut this year that he got 4 years ago. Then he got more black votes than any other president before as a Republican. He got more Hispanic votes, and that's why the Democrats are trying to import new voters, the illegals, and turn them into a permanent underclass so they can make them citizens to vote for the Democrat Party. Because the Democrats, without victims and victimhood, they become an obsolete party, and they are concerned about it. So I don't see Trump as someone who brought shame to our party. Silence? Did I lose you?
Hello, Colby. You still there?
What about Connecticut? He couldn't win Connecticut, and he lost nationally. Well, and you crazy Trump supporters, you keep pushing this conspiracy theory that the election was stolen. There's no evidence for that. Trump lost in court. This is a load of crap.
Well, first of all, you know, I appreciate the call, but you are not a Republican. So why don't you just admit it? You know, you can't fool me. You know, if 92% of the Republicans support Trump,
I'm Antifa. Let me guess. You're going to accuse me of being Antifa.
No, I never said that.
You're Antifa, sir.
Maybe I am, huh? Right. Well, with my 3% hat, I'm Antifa.
Look,
but you don't even know what that is, right? Because your education probably doesn't allow you to.
Look, I mean, obviously, the way you're expressing yourself, sir, is an indictment, actually, of our public education system. And it's sad. It's sad. And I think if you graduated from college, you should call them up and ask them to reimburse you. No, this is not a joke. This is not a joke. I mean it. The reason why Trump didn't win our state, or any Republicans for a while, I think Reagan was the one who won last. 1980 has been a while because our state is moving to the left, and no question about it that we have become a blue state. But Republicans have failed also to organize the Republican Party and strengthen the party and stand for something. This is the problem that I do have as a Republican, that we cannot just say that we're not Democrats. We know that we're Republicans, but if you're not telling me that you stand for 1, 2, 3, 4, and you offer something which is the something alternative to what they offer, I don't blame the voters for not voting Republican. I blame the Republicans for nominating the wrong candidates, and maybe that they made a mistake that didn't nominate me, you know, for governor. Did I lose you again?
Hello.
No, I'm still here. You still haven't answered my question, though.
Trump
was so popular in Connecticut. Why did he lose?
Okay, let me give you a free lesson on our constitutional republic, sir. We don't elect the president by the popular vote. The popular vote to the United States means nothing. We have the Electoral College, which the Democrats are trying to do away with it. The founding fathers were mindful of the fact that people like you one day may become majority, and they will elect a communist to the White House. Therefore, we have to have a layer of protection here, which is the Electoral College. So whether you win the majority vote nationwide or not, that means nothing. Hillary Clinton won more than...
Screw you guys and go to hell along with Trump.
Okay.
Nice talking to you.
Thank you, sir. That's let's start it over again, man. We're Americans. We're brothers. Come on. Relax. But that was some, you know, free education that I provided to him. So, you know, call your institution and get your money back.
You know, I'm really, you should try to call this kid back because he may be jumping out of the window right now. He's so on him.
They want to have some fun too, so don't blame it. I'm fine with that.
So you said one president can't ruin a country in 4 years. It just
of course not.
No.
Yeah. Okay. You know what gets me is that I don't know why, you know, they don't like Trump because they don't like what he says and does, but tell me one policy that he's done that they don't like. They can't tell you.
Okay.
Look, one of the reasons that they keep on talking about Trump, including us here tonight, because we have nothing to talk about the Democrats. They're not doing anything that we can really talk about it. As I said, I mean, we are created to create wealth and equity. It's nothing wrong with capitalism. We have God-given rights. Enumerated powers of the government are there for a reason, to make sure that the government is limited so you and I can be free.
That's why the whole world wants to come in, and none of them want to leave.
And it's interesting because whenever they talk about socialism, I don't see any one of these people moving to a socialist country. They want to come to the United States of America. So talking about the vice president, she will become president soon because he asked me that question about Harris. I think she will become president soon because what the Democrats are going to do, eventually they're going to declare Joe Biden to be incapacitated. They're going to invoke the 25th Amendment, and all you have to do, just get certain people to agree to it. And once they do it,
he's gone.
And she will become president by default. But understand one thing about our Constitution, I'm pretty sure you do. She can be a president for 10 years.
She can?
She could. Because if she becomes president now, because Biden may become disabled or incapacitated, she didn't get elected. So she has the right to run for two more terms. Has never been tested before. It's a theory. Okay. So she can be our president for the next 10 years or 12 years.
And do you think that will be good or a disaster?
No.
Look, it remains to be seen.
Okay.
It remains to be seen because if you have a strong United States Senate, that slows down the president. The Senate is there to shape the policies of the president. And the Senate should never be, from my point of view, from the same party as the president because you have to slow him down or her down. So it depends on what's going to happen with the United States Senate and Congress next, which is in next year.
2022.
Yeah, in 2022. Can she be, you know, someone that, you know, we would have voted for? Just think about this. When she was seeking the nomination for president, how many states did she win?
None.
Zero.
1% of the vote.
Really?
Nothing. She got not even 1% of the vote. I mean, she got picked for that position because of two things that the Democrats are looking for. They have a list of pointers that you have to check. Okay, is a female? We need that. Is this? We need
person
this.
Of color.
And it's no qualification. Absolutely. Nobody's, you know, appointed to that position based on qualification.
Now, Pete, let me ask you a question. Is she black? I know her Indian. And, from the Caribbean. How can they call her a black?
I'll be honest with you. Only the Democrats talk about this crap, and I'm talking.
I know.
I'll be honest with you. I'm just tired of it. When I hear people.
That's what your listeners, I want to know.
And I apologize for using that.
No, you're fine. You're fine.
I'm tired of that crap. I don't wake up in the morning thinking about, okay, I'm not going to talk to this guy because he's black or he's white or he's gay or he's lesbian. I'm just tired of that crap. Democrats are the only ones who are always dividing us into genders, classes, races, and the media is the one that promotes that division because the media and the Democrats are interested in seeing us divided because then they can rule us.
Yeah, control.
I don't think that Americans, we don't wake up in the morning, I couldn't care less about my neighbor, what color, you know, his pigmentation is. Why would I care about that? I had a choice as an Albanian American. When I came here, I could have gone anywhere in the world as a refugee. My brothers and I chose to come to the United States. We knew that there were blacks here and Hispanics here and all these. We couldn't care less. We could have gone to, let's say, Greece that is all white. We didn't choose United States for any other particular reasons, but because of the greatness of this nation and the founding documents of this country is what makes us great. So I wouldn't answer a question that relates to anything that is racial in the United States any longer. Because Democrats, the first thing they will tell you is that if they disagree with you, you're racist, you're sexist, you're homophobe, you're xenophobe. I'm just tired of it. I wouldn't even, you know, entertain answering those questions.
So that's the thing that's what's used now in a debate, pretty much. Yep. You're a racist.
Yeah. Racist or a bigot.
Now, yep. I know you guys have to go soon. George Floyd. The cop that killed him's trial is coming up. How do you feel about that whole, the whole George Floyd, the police officer that was, do you think the way they're handling it is right? And do you think the way the media handled it is right?
First of all, what the officer did to George Floyd, I think, I don't know anyone who could say that they agreed with what the officer did. I think it was disgusting. I can't see him at this point. They're not going to give him a fair trial because it's giving it to him in Minnesota, Minneapolis.
Okay.
And there are already protesters out there. But what I'm most upset about is that they're making George Floyd a poster child.
Okay.
And, you know, that's kind of upsetting. I think it should be upsetting to every black person around that, you know, this guy was in prison. He was a wife beater. He was a drug addict and a drug dealer. And, you know, what they did to him was wrong. No human being should have ever been doing it. But to give him five funerals,
yep.
You know, that's...
The tendency in certain communities is that we turn criminals into heroes. And that is wrong. What happened with Floyd is that the legislative body of that state passed the law that you can use your knee to pin someone down when they resist arrest. Now, the police officer would be part of the executive branch of the government and they have to enforce the law. That law was passed by the legislative body of that state. He didn't do anything else but executed that law, which is a stupid law, should have never been there. He was just doing his job executing the law. If you have a U.S. Marshal or someone knocking on your door right now with a search warrant, that guy is executing the law.
Right.
That law may be wrong. You have to change the law.
You have to change the law.
And they have to change that law. And it changed. Pretty much the entire nation did change the law. But then turning a criminal, unfortunately, into a hero, it is wrong. It's absolutely wrong. Now, if the police officer violated his rights, let the justice system deal with it. He's going to have to face this, and he's going to have to live with this thing for the rest of his life. Mm-hmm. I mean, knowing that maybe because of his actions, this gentleman is dead. So he's going to have to deal with that. And if he did something intentionally, he's going to be responsible before the justice system and God himself. And that's a heavy burden to carry for the rest of your life.
And you said he won't get a fair trial.
I don't think so. You know, we had a situation in East Haven many years ago with Malik Jones.
Yes.
You remember that?
Yes, I do.
And I knew the officer kind of personally back then, and it changed his life. He could never live around, he could never be a cop again. Malik Jones tried to kill him. He tried to run him over with a car.
Okay.
But they made a poster child out of him in New Haven.
That was about 20 years ago?
Yeah, Floodquist was the officer. And ever since that time, East Haven had gotten a bad rap.
Okay.
Which was really unfair because I think we're one of the most beautiful communities there is on the shore.
Yeah.
And things have changed. I think we're doing well in East Haven, but we're always going to have that little thing where people always believe that we are kind of a racist community. But that's the word they always use, you know. They try to use the race card all the time. And many of us are just sick of it.
Okay.
I think Americans eventually are going to come to their senses that playing the victim. You know who's playing the victim in our society right now? The most powerful people in our society.
World, yeah.
You hear Hillary Clinton playing a victim. Oprah playing a victim. Obama's wife, I'm a victim. These are the most powerful people
in
the United States.
Yeah.
And they are playing the victim. Even the lady who...
Now, Prince Harry.
Prince Harry's wife, yeah, and she's a victim now.
Can we grab a call?
Sure.
It's the Roar Report. We got Pete Lumaj and Pete Cianelli up here. Talk to us.
Hello.
Hello.
I gotta chime in. I really, really do. Okay. One, I wanna say, I wanna bring up Kamala Harris. That woman is not black. I'm a black, well, I'm considered black, but her father is not Jamaican. He's an East Indian immigrant that went to Jamaica that got citizenship, like homeboy on the panel with the accent. He's American citizen, but he got citizenship, right?
Well, I think he's Jamaican.
No, he's not.
He's Jamaican because he and I had the weed together.
No, he's Jamaican. He's Indian. Look at my grandma. Look at my
I'm just joking.
No, you're right, honey.
My grandfather's from Portugal. You get what I'm saying?
Yep.
But when he moved here, to everybody else looking at him, he looked like a black man. But really, when we dug, he was a Cape Verdean descent. So during the slave trade, he was brought to Portugal. You get what I'm saying?
Sure.
So when he came here, he speaks Portuguese, but to everybody else, he looks like a black man. You get what I'm saying?
Mm-hmm.
So number two, I wanted to address you. You know, I understand, you know, like everybody with the Christopher Columbus and everything. But, honey, you got to realize, little deer in that little suit, you look so adorable. But Christopher Columbus was a savage, period. My grandmother, my Portuguese grandfather, his wife, my grandmother, she has a brown mother. Her mother was born on a reservation. She's a Native American. But my grandmother is the only lighter-skinned Indian in the family. All my Native American cousins that were born on a reservation, they're all very brown with beautiful long hair. And I asked my grandmother one day, I said, why is your father brown and your mother brown, your sisters, but you're like a lighter skin? She said her mother was raped on the reservation. My grandmother's 94 years old. Okay? So I'm going to get you, like, just make that known to you. If you didn't know, that man came and he was a savage.
No one would deny that.
My grandfather is her father. You get what I'm saying? But, like, Christopher Columbus, you cannot find a land where people already reside. That's not that you didn't find anything, right?
Look,
you get what I'm saying?
No.
You get what I'm saying? It's not a bad thing. But I will tell you, as a brown-skinned person, I am a Trump supporter. And the reason I am a Trump supporter is because I feel like the establishment of politics, these people are career politicians, right?
God
so I feel
you.
Like it, the president and all those seats in the Senate and everything, it should be for the American people. After 40-something years in office, you are not doing anything. Give it up. I love Trump first because everybody thought Obama being the president, he was gonna, you know, which was very encouraging to my brown skin nephew and my family, like, I can be the president, okay? But Trump gave me the drive to really believe, wait a minute, I could be the, this man ain't never held a seat, never been a mayor, he cannot be bought, you can't buy a rich man.
Yep.
But China can buy a Biden with $100-something thousand.
Okay, young lady,
how are you a millionaire / billionaire?
I think you should get into politics.
Are you running for office or not?
No, I'm just the
I think you should.
I think you should, too.
Come on.
I mean, you should come get your hair done. I mean, honestly,
come on. Just do it, okay? What's the website? What's the website so we can start donating?
Rob, get her name and number, and Pete and I will donate to her.
I'll run your campaign for free.
Yeah. Page,
I'll run your campaign for free, okay?
And I'll be your finance director.
Hey, what else you want? Okay, we'll do it, okay?
Strippers. See, I can't be in politics. I want strippers. I like
God bless, man.
That's a great one, honey.
But I'm just saying, everybody should not be afraid of Trump. I feel like Trump, then everybody, he was bankrupt. And I like a person that can pull themselves up from their bootstraps. I like a person that falls down and gets back up. You understand?
Absolutely.
I feel like I like Trump. And one, ever since Trump got out of office as New Haven, the city, Connecticut, as the state, you cannot go on Facebook right now and not see there are missing kids, kidnapped kids. I'm in a group where a girl was kidnapped, and everybody made fun because she was 200 pounds because they were, you know, missing woman, such and such age, 200. And it was a joke to the city, and that lady had to come out like, I was really kidnapped. I was in a hotel, tied up, drugged. Like, you get what I'm saying? Everybody doesn't know Trump is not them. That's why they hate him.
Well, we know that.
He's not of a bird of their feather. He's not.
Tell you one thing. He's coming back in 4 years.
You know it. Don't be. Listen, because if you call the White House right now, the phone is off. Like, if you didn't pay your cell phone bill and your phone got cut off, the phone is off. The lights been off. That man is a president of a dead whole situation of a corporation. Biden is the president of a dead corporation. You will not see. This man is signing bills. If you look at the videos, those pages are blank. Those pages are blank. Don't look at the pictures. Don't watch the video of this man on a movie set. He's on a movie set. That's not even the White House.
I don't think he knows what he's signing. He's being told to sign. Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you so much for calling, all right?
Thank you.
Trump, blagger.
Bye-bye. All right, bye-bye.
Bye.
Have a good night.
That was good.
Oh, wow. All right, all
right. She had a lot of energy.
She does, huh?
I was thinking some more people would call in. They're in the comments.
I think we scared them away.
You scared them away?
I did. I mean, I blocked a couple of them, actually, because they started calling me a racist, so I did block some on Facebook today.
Okay.
Because I got tired of this. But look, you have a beautiful show. You're great because you open this to the public. If they want to call in and express their views and have the debate over here, I think it's very healthy for our society that we have these conversations, and even if they are passionate, as long as we allow our logic and information to supersede our emotions, we can always find what unites us as Americans instead of emphasizing what divides us. And that's why maybe I block a couple of people, because they want to emphasize what separates me from them, and I just don't like that.
Got you. Well, I appreciate you guys coming on. Look, I mean, I know you guys, I know you got to run. I'm
okay for a while.
You okay for a little while?
Yeah. I have my wife outside. Otherwise,
I don't want you.
She's texting me. You better come out now, okay?
Pete, we don't want to get you in trouble.
We don't want to get you in trouble. But I appreciate that. Pete, you're a regular here, so you know anytime, man. You know we can.
I appreciate it. It's good to see you guys. Okay, we got a call.
It's the Raw Report. Talk to us.
Yes, I don't want to debate. I just have a question. I want to talk about the race and ethnicity form, standard form 181. Can you explain that for the people?
Would you repeat the question again?
The standard form 181, the race and ethnicity form?
I'll be honest with you, I'm absolutely ignorant on that topic. So I'm not going to mislead you. If I don't know something, I'm more than willing to tell you that I have no idea what they're talking about.
The political party has to file that when someone gets endorsed. Is that the form?
I don't know. I mean, when you endorse someone, I don't know what it is. But if you can elaborate on that a little, I would appreciate it.
It's not a form of endorsement, I don't think. But it's a race and ethnicity form where you can file with the Office of Management and Budgeting with other documents of being American Indian or Alaska Native, but in black.
I can't help you on that.
I don't have any information on that. I'm pretty sure that when it comes to distributing funds to certain ethnic groups and genders, and I know they take that into account, and so
it don't have a thing about forms. It's just having a status so a people could be looked at in law. Black has no standing at law. That's in the Black's Law Dictionary.
Yeah, I'm not informed about that form. Absolutely, I don't have any knowledge. I mean, I wouldn't have any problems to research it for you, and if you want to contact
Rob could Google it. It's on Google. Yeah, you could Google the standard form 181, and you could read it to the people.
Yeah, I'll plead my ignorance over here. I don't know what it is. I don't know what it is. But thanks, man. I appreciate it. And if you get any information on that, I would love to personally know more about that topic.
I'll definitely look it up.
Yeah, just make a note of it. I would love to know that. So if this topic at least comes up in the future, we'll be more informed that,
But the topic came up when the lady infiltrated the NAACP of that form, but they never told the public about that form. Mm.
I'm at loss here, so I don't.
When she put in the category, she put black and white in that category.
It may be related to, well, when you complete certain forms, they ask you voluntarily your race or ethnicity, and lots of people sometimes.
No, but yeah, but yeah, you will use the word black fluently.
I
like to keep certain cultures in a trap.
Oh,
but so what about the HJR 194?
I'm not good with numbers, I'll be honest with you.
I didn't ask you about a number. It's a government form. Yeah.
I mean, if there is someone out there...
All right, so if you can't answer that one, so what about the Pope apologizing to the indigenous people?
Okay, what about the Pope apologizing to the indigenous people?
So let the people know who are your true indigenous people.
Well, we know who they are, and you know, I mean,
the Pope is way above us
to discuss him, you know, here in Hamden. Before
Columbus came here, right? It was Native people here, correct?
No one denies that.
Yeah, before the Native people were the Neanderthals.
We're not going to go back to the 1400s.
No. I'm just asking questions. Don't get uptight, please.
No. We're gonna have to be here forever to discuss.
Those were the indigenous people.
No one denies that, sir. We're not denying that. No one is denying that.
Okay.
We're trying to have a 21st century, you know, argument or debate here. But
I don't want to argue. I don't want to debate. I'm stating facts.
Well, no, I'm not denying that. We're not denying that.
This is commerce, ain't it? Ain't it commerce?
Yeah, we're not denying that.
This is big business.
Yeah, we're not denying that.
This is commerce, correct?
Yeah. We're not denying that. It's a fact. Okay. It's a fact that they were here.
No problem, sir. Okay, much appreciated.
Absolutely.
Much appreciated.
Absolutely, sir. Yes. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir.
Yes.
Okay.
So,
Rob, what's up?
Do you mind if I hit the road? No, please. I appreciate you. Everybody, Pete had to take off. Appreciate you. Can you open that and get out? Okay. Okay, thank you, man. I appreciate it.
You got it.
Drive slow.
So repeat. So Christopher Columbus.
No. Okay, let's change the subject.
You don't want to talk Christopher Columbus. So do you think Trump will be back 2024?
I definitely think he's going to be back in 2020, and a big indication of that is going to see what his what the Trump daughter does in North Carolina if she runs for the Senate.
The daughter's running for Senate?
Yeah, daughter-in-law, maybe, I think it is.
Okay, I know who you're talking about. Yeah, she's going to make a run.
Yeah, if she runs for the Senate in North Carolina, she's going to win.
She's going
to
win.
And if she decides to run for the Senate, I think Trump is going to maybe think about 224. A lot of things could happen. You know, no one knows what's going to happen. I think if it was 223 and we're at today, he'd be definitely running.
Really? Well, he's definitely
a fighter. He doesn't like to lose.
He definitely believes in his heart that the election was rigged.
Sure, he sure does.
I didn't know all that stuff that Pete said about the politicians in Connecticut having these issues with election fraud and stuff like that. I know that you're a strong Trump guy. And don't forget, y'all can call in and talk to Pete. Number is 203-494-0708. I'm shocked that the phone hasn't been going crazy tonight. I am shocked. It's usually is a crazy house in here. Are you running for any kind of office?
Oh no. Not me. I like to support the people who I want to see elected into office.
Okay.
You know, but as far as that's a tough thing to do. I worked my whole life.
I
had a real job.
You had a real job.
I had a real job.
And you guys were saying this $1,400 does not make sense.
No, it doesn't make sense at all. It's going to the wrong people.
So,
you know, why should we give Pakistan millions of dollars? They hate us.
Okay.
Why should we give Iran and all these other foreign countries billions of dollars? For what? This is why, you know, we were talking about the gas prices earlier. Wait till you see the gas prices in another 6 months. It's going to be higher than
I know this morning. I went to get gas. It was $2.64.
Oh, yeah.
Now it's for the cheap shit.
Closed down the pipeline, and, you know, we got to be independent on our oil for the first time in history. And now we're doing
it. And now it's back.
Yeah.
It's back
to. Come on. This is. It's insane what the left is going to be doing to our country. It's insane. And if the young people don't wake up and they don't start listening and they don't start reading and they don't start investigating on what's going on, you know what? If you're going to say to yourself, wake up one morning, what happened?
Really?
And this is how close it is. I'm very pessimistic about the future.
Really? Now, when you say the 1,400 going to the wrong people, do you mean people in America as far as...
No, I think like people like myself who are retired.
Okay.
I haven't lost a penny of income with this pandemic.
Okay.
I still get my Social Security check. I still get my operating engineer's pension check because I was a crane operator my whole life.
Okay.
And I didn't lose any income. So why should I be getting more money?
Got you. So do you think people...
I think my kids deserve more money. You know, my daughter who's a bus driver, the other one who's a 911 operator, and, you know, who's raising kids and, you know, things like that. Those are the people that needed it, and especially the ones who are unemployed.
Now, I have a tough question for you.
Okay.
People that are already on government assistance, Section 8, Housing Authority, food stamps, should they get it?
Well, yeah, they're the most needy.
Okay.
Yeah, I believe they should.
Okay.
Yeah, they're the most needy, and they should get it. But I don't think if they get the money, they shouldn't be able to not pay their landlords the rent.
Got you.
You know, you have these landlords that own buildings, and they're, you know, in New Haven, all the restaurants that are closed in New Haven, and all the bars, and you know, these guys, they got to pay their mortgages. These owners of these buildings, they're not getting their money from the businesses.
Okay.
So that means that the banks aren't getting money from the landlords. And we may have a domino effect where it will affect our economy like it did in the banking crisis in 2008.
Gotcha.
And that's how it's all started.
Okay. Gotcha. Gotcha. So you believe that, and I see some people up here that wanted me to ask you about the NRA. How obviously you feel that you have the right to carry?
Oh, of course we do. It's our Second Amendment freedoms. We have the right to own arms, and it doesn't say anything in the Constitution of what arms you could have.
Right.
So if I have an AR-15, which everyone's calling an assault rifle, but it really isn't an assault rifle because it's an Armalite.
What's that mean?
That's just the make of the model of the rifle.
Okay.
It just looks mean, but it still's like a 380 or 305, you know, any other type of rifle that fires 223 rounds.
Gotcha.
And but they're making it all sound like, you know, we're the problem. The problem is in the minority communities, they're killing themselves. They're not legal gun owners. It's going out into the look at all the crime that's happening since this pandemic started. Look at all the car robberies. That they don't know what's happening, where it's coming from.
Right.
You know, they talk about the NRA. The NRA is for our freedoms and our liberties.
Right.
And I'm going to support them. I give money to them. I'm a card member.
Right.
And this is what it's all about.
Now, police, do you think anything should be done to, like, switch up the way everything operates? Like, should the police be defunded? Should they just remain as is, or should they be training as far as mental evaluations and somebody that that's not mentally fit? Should there be like some kind of training, or do you think police should be defunded?
No, the worst thing in the world is that you're going to want to defund the police. Of course they need more training.
Okay.
You know, we're in a different world now. We're in a world now where everybody has their cell phones or taping everything. But
right.
You're not getting you're only seeing the recording of when they started. You don't know what happened in the beginning.
Okay.
Or what happened in the end. You know, this is the toughest position in the world right now is to be a police officer.
Okay.
And I feel for them every time. And every time I see one of them in a restaurant or Dunkin' Donuts, I'll buy them their coffee.
Oh, really?
Oh, yeah. You know, I have family that are police. I have a lot of friends that are police.
Okay.
Cousins, you know, and I really feel for their safety, and they don't know how to handle the situation anymore because it's out of control. They lost, the people, many of the people lost respect for the badge.
Okay.
And it's a very difficult position to be now, to be a police officer.
Now, do you think that's all politics as well?
Oh, sure. The politicians are destroying the police forces.
Do you think that happened with George Floyd, or it was before that?
Oh, no. This has been brewing for years.
Really?
You know, I don't think anyone knows the answer. I sure don't know the answer. I have my opinions, but, you know, they could be out in left field someplace.
Right.
But it's over my head. I think there has to be smart people. They're going to have to make smart decisions to go into the next 10, 15, 20 years because our society as we know it is starting to fall apart.
And you think that will be...
You just told me earlier in the evening about when you were driving around, this guy pulled up on the side of you and started screaming at you.
Right, right. That happened.
You know, this is it's crazy.
It just happened yesterday.
Yeah.
Yeah. Now, I think we need police.
Oh,
absolutely.
Of course.
We absolutely need police. Do you think it'll get worse with Biden in power?
Yeah, because he's not giving them the support.
Now, is that because it's trendy now to not give support to the police?
Yeah, well, don't forget, he has the progressive side of his party that want to defund the police. Now, imagine going to a 911 call where there's probably firearms and the cops got to bring a doctor along with them, a psychiatrist.
All right.
You know, that's kind of dumb.
Let me get a buzzer. Hold on. Right, right. Okay, I got you. I see what you're getting at. Now, so you're still going to be in the movement. You're still going to be...
Oh, I will be right up front. I attended all the rallies. I had a rally myself in East Haven, which was very successful.
I remember that one I was at?
Yeah, the one you were at.
Okay, yeah, it was. There was a lot of people there. Now, did race play a part in any of those rallies you was at?
No. It's good that you brought this up because we had planned a big rally the month before.
Okay.
And it was going to be a combination of a Freedom Rally and Blue Lives Matter rally. And I'm going to tell you something. It got so crazy on social media.
Hold on, caller.
Go ahead. We were expecting maybe 1,000 people.
Uh-huh.
And when that happened, I had people coming to my house begging me to cancel it. So I had the assistant chief of the police and a detective come to my house at 3:00 in the afternoon. And they said, Pete, you know, do us a favor. Postpone this rally. I was so mad. Because I was doing it for them, not, you know. We have intel that there's Black Lives Matter is going to show up.
Okay.
Well, what are you worried about? We're going to have more weapons there than you have in your police department.
Okay.
We're not worried about that. Well, you know, please, you know this. So I canceled that rally, and that was the mistake because I should have held it.
Go ahead, caller.
What's going on, Dad?
What's going on?
What's his name, Peter?
Peter, yes. Yeah. Yes, sir.
How you doing, Peter?
Good, I'm fine, thank you.
I had a question from what you said earlier in the show about the George Floyd thing.
Yeah.
When you were saying how he had a criminal record and he shouldn't be a poster boy and stuff like that.
Okay.
So I feel like, me personally, I feel like when an African-American is killed by police or even a white person that's, you know, probably had a license to carry in somewhere like Florida or something like that. When they take an African American and the media pretty much paint them as a bad person, like it's kind of been known that.
Yeah, I agree with you. I agree with you.
So if you agree with me, then what was the reason for you saying?
Well, I agree with you that over the years the media had, you know, given the bad rap to many of the black people. I agree with that part. But what I don't agree with is what they did with the George Floyd. Now, what they did with him was wrong. I've said it numerous times. I think what the cop did was disgusting. But what happened afterwards? Was it worth to burn down cities and towns? See, Black Lives Matter, that movement was started to be a wonderful movement that was hijacked by Antifa. And the protesters who were peaceful protesters, they were infiltrated by 30, 40, 50 people that wanted to make destruction. And who got blamed for it? But Black Lives Matter. And you guys...
I get that, and I agree. Nobody should, you know, loot, burn down. But what I'm saying is because I can't... I'm only paraphrasing on what you said, but you pretty much said because he had a record, I think you said he's a woman beater and stuff. I mean, we personally don't know if anybody can be murdered or by the police. They're going to take any story that even someone, probably a rumor, and run that through the ground with the media. We all know that.
I didn't get your first day, but did you follow that whole Floyd thing from the beginning?
I feel like we all did.
Okay, now what did you feel of the night that the black officer got shot and killed and murdered? Did you feel bad for him? Yeah, Minnesota.
I mean, I feel bad for anybody.
I know, but why is it that guy didn't get headlines, and the police that got beat up and the other one that lost his eye didn't get headlines, and the cops that got killed in Houston?
What was it, four cops on?
Yeah, I know, but why didn't they get the headlines? They were murdered by criminals.
I mean, you got to take that up with the media, whoever.
No, but I'm taking it up with you because you're mentioning how I'm talking about George Floyd. But I'm asking you as a black person, why weren't you outraged of those cops being murdered like you were outraged with George Floyd being murdered?
You said black cops being murdered?
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm outraged of any African-American.
I know, but I didn't see no protesting and walking by Black Lives Matter in support of the police officer.
Well, I mean, you're asking me. I can't.
Because you're asking me about George Floyd. I'm asking you.
Yeah, but I feel like you're running away from what I'm saying. Pretty much, you pretty much said because he had a record, he should have been a poster boy for it, right?
Oh no, I don't think that was
exactly
the right.
That's exactly what you just said.
I agree, and I stand by it. I don't think George.
So if why is that a problem though? If he was murdered without doing anything, it don't matter what his criminal record was or who he did what to in the past, he was murdered by four or five cops.
Okay.
And somebody's on his neck for what, 9 minutes?
Yeah, listen.
That's wrong. You said that they were wrong. What he did in the past has nothing to do with anything.
Okay, so if you believe racist, that. Okay, let me finish. Now, let me talk. Let me answer you. What I'm trying to say is that we all agree that it was disgusting what the cop did, right? You agree?
Yeah, so the conversation should be over.
Okay, but now, do you agree that he should have had 5 different funerals?
I mean, whatever. Do you agree?
Do you agree that hundreds of cops should have been injured? 4 cops should have been murdered because of what one cop did to one black man?
What does that have to do with George Floyd being?
Because George Floyd was that one black man that started all the riots in our country.
He didn't start nothing. The cops started by killing him.
Come on.
Right or wrong? So did George Floyd put himself in a position to be murdered that day?
Yeah, he did put himself in a position because he tried to attack the cop.
How did he do that?
Come on now. You knew he was high on drugs. He was resisting arrest. And they're going to find out through the trial that the cop didn't kill him. He was dying from all the drugs in his system. Now, come on, let's call a spade a spade.
We are, because I watched the videos. I'm sure you probably did the same thing. And Rob could pull him up too. When there's body cam of him getting into the car and him coming out of the car like, yo, I can't be.
Well,
like,
one thing we both agree on, son, is
look, you see what I'm saying? You cut me up. I'll let you talk, right? Let me talk now.
Okay.
So with the video, they pretty much said, you know, yeah, he committed a crime. So they say, we don't know. Because you're just going off of what the media told you. And I'm doing the same thing. But I did see the body cam where he was in a police car. He got out. 4 cops put him on the ground after he was like, yo, listen, I'm not resisting. I'm not going to go anywhere. I'm in handcuffs. And they still proceeded to put pressure on him and his neck. When the cop that killed him wasn't even at the other 2 cops already had it under control, right?
Yeah, but I'm not debating that. I agree with you 100%.
So what are you talking about?
No, what are you talking about?
You pretty much just said that he pretty much was a criminal. He did X, Y, and Z.
No,
listen. You said he was high on drugs.
He was. Everything that I said was factual.
So how could you say you agree with me and now you're
I agree with you on how it happened.
So how did he die on drugs?
Well, what do you mean, how did he die on drugs?
This conversation is not going to go anywhere.
Okay.
So
Yeah, well, hey, have a great night.
Yeah, you do the same thing. Okay, so see you later.
Thank bye-bye. You. Okay, that was
that was good. No, that, I like it.
That was good.
Nice kid.
That was so you believe that in the trial things are going to come up?
I really think things are going to come up that is. I don't think this cop is going to be convicted of second degree murder. He may be convicted of another offense,
but not second degree murder.
Not second degree or first degree murder. No.
It's the Raw Report. Talk to us.
Hey, Rob. What's good, man?
What's going on?
Hey man, I'd like to talk to Pete for a second.
He can hear you.
Hi, how are you?
Oh, I'm doing good.
Pete. Great.
Hey man, listen man, this is where a lot of the stuff get misconstrued.
Okay.
When it comes to you guys, man.
What do you mean you guys?
When I say you guys, I mean conservatives.
Okay.
You know, you spew one message, but it turns out to be something else every time. You know. We as a country missed the mark in the very beginning of including everyone to be as one person, to be as one nation, to be as one country. That was the first mark we missed. So after that, you know, we had presidents and congressmen and senators that represented each state saying, this is what our people want. And we went along with that. And we were told that as long as you keep your nose clean, you get an education, you abide by the law, you are considered a model American.
Who said that?
What you mean, who said that?
Yeah, who said that?
That's what America says.
Oh, America says that?
America says...
Oh, that's America said that according to you?
Well, or is it written? Well, if it's been proven, if you educate yourself and you keep your nose clean and you stay out of trouble.
That's anybody. Told, that's a white guy. That's an Indian. That's an Asian. That's a Latino.
That's what I'm saying. But that's what I'm saying. I'm just saying as a person. Period. I'm just saying you're considered a model American. That's
exactly.
All I'm saying.
Okay, right. A model American. I never heard of a model American, though.
Yeah. I'm not saying what color. I'm just saying. Okay, so when we do all of this, we don't get the consideration that we think we should get.
Who's that? You're talking about the black community?
And that's the black community.
Okay.
Actually, that's... Now we're beginning to see that's anybody that's called themselves a liberal or a Democrat. You don't have to be black. See, that's what a lot of people have gotten misconstrued. You don't have to be black or any other color.
Well, just as long as you're 92% of the black community are Democrats.
Okay, well, but no, 92% of 100% of the black community are Americans.
Exactly.
See, we really don't consider ourselves to be Democrat, Republican, independence or nothing. We consider ourselves.
Well, why is it that Trump got 8% of the black vote and Biden got 92% black vote, a Republican and a Democrat?
Because
with
Donald Trump standing up there, there was only one group of people that swore up and down he was fighting for America.
Why?
When not everybody
what did,
felt
what
like
did
that.
Donald Trump's policy do that made you vote against him? What policy? Not what he says or how he acted. What policy measure? It was the lowest black unemployment in the history.
No. It was you guys. It was the conservatives that turned us against Donald Trump.
Oh,
Donald Trump really didn't do nothing wrong.
Me?
It was the way you guys started acting. It was the way that y'all started coming up against black people and saying this and Black Lives Matters and Antifa and all that. See, this is the thing, Pete. See, I heard you say something about Antifa hijacked the Black Lives Matter movement,
it
right?
It did.
Okay, but that was not y'all argument at the White House and on the streets. Y'all were just condemning the Black Lives Matter. Y'all didn't come out and say, hey, listen, we stand with the Black Lives Matter, but we are against Antifa. See, y'all just condemned the whole thing as a whole. You blamed it on black people. You blamed it on Antifa.
Well, you know what? Wait a minute. Didn't Black Lives Matter and Antifa burn down Minnesota?
We don't know who done it.
Well, come on. You mean to tell me, what, you got a black and white TV? You don't have a color TV?
No, Pete. What I'm saying is, the people that actually got caught for starting fires and stuff, they got charged.
Oh,
and
they
the
did?
The ones that are bad, I'm with you, Pete. I'm with you on one thing. The people that turn Black Lives Matter into something that other than what it originally started out to be, yes, they are at fault.
Okay,
but
thank you.
But you should not blame the whole movement.
Oh, of course not. I don't.
Okay, then. So don't keep deflecting your argument back to the Black Lives Matter or George Floyd. Now, I'm going to tell you what happened with George Floyd. Now, the cop didn't know he was going to kill him.
Nope. I don't think any cop knows they're going to kill
somebody. He didn't know he was going to kill him. But, Pete, you know what the main ingredient is?
Control.
He didn't care.
Yeah, he wanted control of the situation.
He didn't care if he killed him or not. And since he didn't care, yes, he should pay for that.
You know what? There is not one time since this George Floyd incident that I agreed with what the police officer did. Never in any of my Facebook posts, my Twitter feeds, or anything at all, I said the cops were wrong. The cops that were standing by the side watching it, they were wrong. And the whole situation was wrong.
Yes, yes, absolutely.
So we're on the same page there, brother.
Yeah, absolutely. But, you know, we have to stop downplaying it like it did not happen.
Yeah, but it's all over. How many more years are we going to play for it?
Huh?
How long are we going to play this Gage's George Floyd situation? It's done. It's over with. You burnt down Baltimore. You burnt down Minnesota. You burnt down Kansas City. You know, it's got to be over.
No. But see, that's the trouble right there. You're putting everybody in the same box. You're saying you did it, and I live in North Carolina. I ain't have nothing to do with that.
Yeah, I agree. Okay, yeah, you didn't.
If you're right about
people in North Carolina wouldn't have allowed it.
Let me tell you something.
I could tell by the way you're talking that if you were in a Black Lives Matter movement protest and you saw something happening, you would have been the one of the black guys that would have stopped it.
Absolutely.
Okay, so there we're on the same page. That's why it wouldn't have happened in North Carolina.
And Pete, believe me or not, the media might have not showed you.
No.
But it was people out there stopping people from doing that.
Yes, there were. Those people were heroes.
I absolutely believe it. But Pete, you have to listen, man, you have to the thing is when you see people begging each other to do the right thing, be a good person, give your best, try your hardest, and then just totally switch up when something outside of their race or outside of their party or outside of their beliefs happen, they dig in with both heels and they don't give the other person a chance to breathe.
Yep.
They don't want to listen. They don't want to hear it. You're so dug in that it just don't matter what nobody else says because you have already convinced yourselves that you are right and there's no other way around it.
Well, just talking to you, son, makes me feel better about maybe we do have a future. Just by talking to someone like you.
Just by you listening makes me feel like we got a chance.
No, that's great.
So, Rob,
yes,
you're
sir.
A big dude. You know I've loved your platform from the day you started, man. You know that.
And I appreciate you. I appreciate you.
Yeah, man. And Pete,
hey.
Keep having that conversation, man.
I hope I meet you someday, son.
Thanks. We're going to grab this call, all right?
All you got to do is come down to Carolina Beach, man, and bring your fishing pole. That's all you got to do.
I'll be down in Oak Island in the summertime.
All right, man.
Down to Oak Island, but come on down.
Okay,
man.
Bye-bye.
Hello, it's the Roar Report. Talk to us.
Rob, what's up? This is George. How you doing?
George, what's going on, man?
Hey, nothing. I'm very, I'm digging the show.
Okay.
Now listen.
Okay.
I can't hear him.
What's up, Rob?
Yeah, we can hear you. Go ahead.
Listen, Pete, how you doing?
Yeah, I'm doing fine. How are you, son?
Good. Now, my issue is this. The stimulus package, I totally agree with Pete.
Okay.
Okay, so everything is in delay for some reason. Am I doing something wrong here, Rob?
Yeah. No, you got to turn. Are you listening to something in the background?
Yeah, you got to turn your radio or turn the TV down on your side.
TV's off.
Okay.
All right, now go ahead. Okay, we can hear you.
Now we hear you. Great.
So here's my deal.
Okay. Maybe you should have him call back.
George, call back. When you call back, don't have anything turned up. It's like the radio. It's a delay on your end.
Okay, I'll call back.
Okay.
So, hey, listen, I'm enjoying myself tonight. I love your show.
Okay.
I'd love, you know, the guests have been great.
Now, what I want to do...
Guy, you know, with the Indians.
Yeah, let's grab this last one, okay. and we're going to get up, wrap it up.
Okay.
George, is that you?
That's me.
How do we sound now? Everybody on point?
I hear everything.
Okay, good.
Okay. So the stimulus package, I am totally in agreement with Pete. I didn't agree with everything he said, but when it comes to that stimulus package, it's absurd.
Mm-hmm.
Like Pete said, why people like me, I'm retired.
Okay.
I miss a dime. Why am I receiving any money?
Right.
Or anybody else receiving that money, why are they receiving it? Let me tell you what I call that stimulus package.
What do you call it?
It's called the Democratic Keep You in the Hood.
No. Stuck in the hood. You nailed it.
Stuck in the hood. Let me tell you why. Instead of give, and I think the Democratic Party is probably the biggest enablers in the world when it comes to our people.
I feel so good right now. This kid
is because. Listen, now, people don't agree with me when I say this, but it's true. I'm no Trump.
You don't have to be a Trump. You're talking from what you believe in yourself.
I'm a fucking Republicrat.
Okay.
I'm a Republicrat. So instead of providing training, teaching people how to keep the money, make the money, grow your money, help your community, they give. Keep you stuck in the hood. Keep your mouth shut.
Yep.
Thank you.
And every 4 years, they come in around wanting your vote.
Here you go. There you go, Pete. You're dead right. You're dead right, Pete. Totally.
Well, you know what?
Me.
Maybe the young people like you are waking up. Maybe the young black community is waking up.
Listen, I get into debates with my peoples about this all the time, and they call me Trump supporter. They don't even know who I like and what I don't like.
Yep.
Because it ain't none of their business.
Well,
I
you
like
know
the
what?
People.
Stand, I like the people. Stand by your principles in life, even if you have to stand alone.
Yep. Now, I'm not a Trump supporter.
No, I'm just telling you to stand by your principles.
Oh, definitely.
Even if you have to stand alone.
Definitely.
You will become a great person.
At $1.9 trillion, when you see like the gas is going up, watch when the taxes go up.
Oh.
Yo, the working man is a sucker. That is such a true statement.
This is the beginning of the end.
It's sad.
It really is. It's sad. That's why you know I talked with Rob in the beginning before we even went on air. Is that you know I fear for my grandchildren. I really really do because they're not going to be able to have the life that I had. Never.
Yeah, well, guess what, Pete? I hope my grandkids don't have the life that I had.
Oh, well, you know what?
So you're in a good position. Well, you're in a good position.
Well, you know what? I probably am. I'm very thankful and, you know, I'm blessed and I believe it. You know, I know it. But I worked hard my whole life. You know, I worked at a friggin' junkyard. I was a crane operator. I worked 70 hours a week.
I picked tobacco at 14, Pete.
Okay, you know, and I washed dishes. I washed dishes at 11 at Mike and Mary's restaurant.
Right.
I had a taste of slavery.
And then I played in the band my whole life.
Suckering tobacco. I know.
Okay, son.
I know the struggle.
Well, you know what? You're going to be a better person for it.
Oh, I'm loving life in this journey right now.
Okay, good for you.
George,
Rob is my boy.
I need you to lock my number in and give me a call when we're off the air. We could talk and meet up.
Okay, definitely.
Yeah, Rob, why don't you come to my house, though, for
dinner? Yeah, absolutely. Absolutely. George, sure. Make sure you lock my number in. I'm going to lock yours in.
Okay.
All right.
George, nice talking to you.
You too. Stay safe, Pete.
Okay.
They're gunning for you. They're gunning for you.
Don't worry. I'm carrying right now. Don't worry about it.
Hey, so am I.
I got my Smith & Wesson 2.0 45.
Oh, wow. You got some.
I got a 9, a 380, and a 357 Bulldog 1980.
Okay, let's go shooting.
Yeah. All right.
I'll talk to you soon, son.
All right, George. Pete, it's been a pleasure, man.
It's been my pleasure.
You're welcome. We got to do this again.
Oh, definitely.
We want to get some Democrats across the table.
Yeah, I want to debate.
You want to debate?
Yeah, but they won't come.
They won't come.
No.
You don't think they'll come?
I don't think they're gonna. Well, maybe if I'm here, they'll come. But if Peter Lumaj is here,
they won't come.
They'll be scared.
They'll be absolutely. I really appreciate it. I thought the calls were going to be a little more crazier tonight, but...
You know what? We were telling the truth.
Okay.
And they couldn't. You know, it's hard to, you know, when you're going to call up and you're going to try to debate someone and you don't have a defense.
Okay.
I know if I was on the other side, I wouldn't want to debate Pete Lumaj.
Right. Cause he knows his shit.
Yeah.
And you know your shit, yeah, too. I mean...
So...
If I,
but you know what? All your callers were, you know, they were really smart callers. Called this guy George, a kid from North Carolina. I really enjoyed him.
Right, right, right. George was the last guy to call. He worked in the Department of Corrections, I think, for like 30 years.
And, oh wow!
And retired. But I want to, next time you guys come on, I want to get some Democrats up here, and maybe some Democrats that are I know you don't want to talk to her, Ellick. Would you debate
her? I would debate anybody.
Anybody.
Oh, anybody.
Doesn't matter.
Doesn't matter.
All right.
Get Kamala.
I like Kamala. I like the way you said her name. Kamala. Everybody, really appreciate you watching. I want to thank Pete Lumaj. And there was two Petes here tonight. Want to thank them guys for coming through. Everybody that called in, really appreciate you. And check us next Tuesday. We got a show coming. We're going to try to do some things. I really appreciate you guys watching. It's the Roar Report. We're out of here. Peace out.